Hello students, looking at current affairs for 26th October, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these 15. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, Sena sets terms, will talk only to Shah. So this is regarding Maharashtra Legislative Assembly. The elections were held, the results are out, and BJP Shiv Sena Alliance, which is known as Mahayuti. So this is the term Mahayuti, which is the name given to the BJP Shiv Sena Alliance in Maharashtra. Here they have one majority, but BJP's performance has been less than expected. So Shiv Sena is now keeping its terms. It has said that it will have, you know, discussions on future of government formation only with the top authority. So it says, you know, meeting would be held, talks would be held only at the top level. So they want to talk to the BJP President Amit Shah, that is the present Home Minister too. So BJP's parliamentary board has now authorized party president Amit Shah to speak to Shiv Sena president Uddhav Thackeray on the shape of the coalition government in Maharashtra after the assembly election results. So senior Shiv Sena leader Uddhav Thackeray, he has said that first condition was speaking only to the top level, at the top level, and then second is that they want, Shiv Sena wants rotational chief ministership. That is, in the 5-year term, BJP will have its chief minister for 2.5 years and Shiv Sena for the rest of the term. So this is the second demand being made, and also it said that Shiv Sena will not settle for anything less than 50-50 formula. So this is there. Also in Maharashtra Legislative Assembly, nearly 12 independents who got elected are either BJP or Shiv Sena rebels. And more than 30 seats are there in which rebels played spoilsport. Otherwise, they would have won these seats too. So, that is a point being raised as such. Then next is BJP, JJP join hands to form government in Haryana. So, there were two state legislative assemblies where elections were held. One Maharashtra, second one was Haryana. In Haryana, BJP became the single largest party but did not get majority. In Haryana legislative assembly, there are 90 seats. So, out of the 90 seats, BJP felt short by 6 seats. And independent members also have claimed that pledged support to BJP. The 8 such independents have pledged support to BJP, and BJP has now joined hands with the political party Jananayak Janata Party, which made debut in Haryana elections. So BJP and JJP together would form the government in Haryana. So JJP leader is Dushyant Chautala. So chief ministership will go to BJP and deputy chief minister will be from JJP. So that's the arrangement being made here. So BJP had support of independents, and 10 MLAs of JJP will now give it comfortable majority. So this is there. Also, JJP support means it does not have to, BJP does not have to get support from Gopal Kanda, who is actually presently an independent member, but he is controversial because he actually is related, a case is going on against him in of rape and suicide of air stewardess Nitika Sharma. Then next is Murmu is Lieutenant Governor of Jammu and Kashmir. Mathur will go to Ladakh. So we know that Jammu and Kashmir will be bifurcated into two union territories, Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh. This has been announced on August 5 when special status of Jammu and Kashmir has been revoked, and actually a bill has been passed to bifurcate Jammu and Kashmir into two union territories. So this will come into effect on 31st October. So the two union territories will have two different lieutenant governors. So they have been announced by the president. So Jammu and Kashmir governor Satyapal Malik, he has been transferred to Goa. So he's the governor in Goa. And expenditure secretary Girish Chandra Murmu, he has been appointed as lieutenant governor of Jammu and Kashmir, and Radha Krishna Mathur as lieutenant governor of Ladakh. This is there. These two union territories will come into existence on 31st October 2019, when India will again have 28 states and 9 union territories. So this is there. Also, former chief of the intelligence bureau and Centre's chief interlocutor for Jammu and Kashmir, Dineshwar Sharma, he has been appointed as administrator to Lakshadweep. So islands have governors who are called administrators or lieutenant governors. So that is. There's further information given regarding Mr. Girish Chandra Murmu. He is 1985 batch IAS officer of Gujarat cadre. He will be lieutenant governor of Jammu and Kashmir. He will retire as expenditure secretary from Union Finance Ministry by this month's end, and immediately he'll take over as lieutenant governor. He has also served as Principal Secretary to Prime Minister Narendra Modi when he was Gujarat's Chief Minister. Then next is, in Haryana, dozen MLAs face criminal cases. So as many as 12 MLAs, it is said, in the newly elected 90-member Haryana State Assembly have criminal cases against them. Also, out of 90 members, only 9 women have been elected this time. So earlier there were 13 and now only 9. Also, 12 MLAs against whom there are criminal cases, 4 are from Congress, and all 4 of them have cases of serious nature against them. When BJP has 2 members with criminal cases. Also, 7 independents, out of them, 3 have cases against them. And this is a cause of concern. It is said 29 MLAs have been re-elected from the last Legislative Assembly. And Jannayak Janata Party is a new political party being formed, which also has the richest, as such, with average assets of the MLAs being 25.26 crores. Well, you should know that JJP is a new party which has made its debut in these elections. It has been formed after a split in INLD, the political party from Haryana here. Also, who is the richest member in the new house is Balraj Kundu, as such. He has assets worth 141 crores. He is an independent MLA. Then next is, Gujarat firm wins consultancy bid to redevelop Central Vista. So we have seen how the government is keen on redevelopment of Central Vista. So you should know what is Central Vista too. It is detailed out here. So it is 2.5 kilometer long Rajpath, the path which is from Rashtrapati Bhavan to India Gate. So there are 44 buildings around it, including the Parliament House, South Block, North Block. Everything falls in Central Vista zone. So, the idea is that this entire 4 square kilometer zone should be replanned. So, a new master plan is proposed to be formulated as such, keeping into consideration values and aspirations of New India. So, it should be rooted in Indian culture and social milieu. So, the master plan has to be made for this, and plan is to build new iconic structures. That will be a legacy for 150 to 200 years. Parliament House will also be revamped. No, building an additional structure in the vicinity of or a completely new complex may take place. Also, common central secretariat to house ministries, departments as such is planned by March 2024. So for this, bidding took place, and now the news is, it has been in news for long, the Central Vista and parliament revamp plan. So an Ahmedabad based architecture firm HCP Design Planning and Management has won the bid. It has been chosen by the central government for the revamp of Parliament and Central Vista, and also developing a new common central secretariat. So it would now have to prepare a master plan. So consultancy bid has been won by it. It will prepare a master plan for the entire area. So first the planning has to take place, then it will be put into effect. So for these services, it would be paid a consultancy fees of 229.75 crore rupees. Union Housing and Urban Affairs Minister announced this. He said it was 40% less than initial estimate of 448 crore rupees. Means this is just for planning, not for actually having the structure established, but for planning. So this consultancy fees, it is said consultancy fees is generally 3-5% of the total cost of the project. So the total cost of the project, which Central Public Works Department's officials estimate, is around 12,450 crore rupees. So this is the amount of money which the government will spend, and it wants it ready by 2021. You can see deadlines are 2021 for revamping the Central Vista, the 3 kilometer long stretch, 2022 for Parliament redevelopment, and 2024 for the construction of the Common Central Secretary. It means from 2019-20 to 2024, in these 4 years, the government is going to spend 12,450 crore rupees plus these 229.75 crore rupees on this additional infrastructure, or grant structure, which it plans to build. So this is the way in which money is being spent at a time when the situation of the economy is such where the economy needs money. So this is the plan of the government. So here you have the further details too. You can see, it is said that the Housing Affairs Minister, you can see, Housing and Urban Affairs Minister, Mr. Hardeep Singh Puri, he says that the buildings like Parliament House, North and South blocks were constructed 100 years ago and did not have the space and amenities needed today. But then work is going on. So redevelopment of course may be a necessity, but it may be done at a time when the economy is doing well, at a time when the social schemes are doing well, when we have been able to achieve the objectives of, you know, everybody has education, everybody has food, everybody has health insurance covered. So if that is the situation in the economy, everybody is well to do, you can have such extravagant expenditure being done. Otherwise expenditure, of course government needs to spend, but government needs to spend in areas where a huge number of people get money in their hands as such, and it gives a boost to the economy. So that is there. So of course there is criticism on the other side, not just on spending but also on these heritage buildings being affected. So on that it has clarified that they would not be demolished. So it wants to build new, and these blocks, Parliament, North and South blocks would not be demolished, but the minister says that their usage could change. So they will also stay, and it is said that it is, you know, not efficient, but still it will continue to function. Means there will be money, there will be maintenance of these buildings also done, and these new buildings which would be established would also be taken care of. Maintenance in every way, electricity and usage as such. So it's completely extravagant. Then next is, activists cry foul as government notifies RTI rules. So the activists have decried new rules under RTI Act that have reduced the tenure of information commissioners from 5 years to 3 years. So actually the government had amended the RTI Act in 2019, but it happened on August 1, 2019, when even the president gave his assent to this RTI Amendment Act. And it had to prescribe rules to put them into effect, put RTI into effect, but it did not prescribe rules for the last 3 months. And now it has come forth with these rules, which has this huge name, you can see. Means it is RTI rules, but in bracket you have it, it is regarding terms of office, salaries, allowances and other terms and conditions of service of Chief Information Commissioner, Information Commissioners in Central Information Commission, State Chief Information Commissioner and State Information Commissioners in State Information Commission. So for the information commissioners, term has been reduced from 5 years to 3 years, and activists say that this is going to affect the independence of the information commissions. So these rules have been notified, this rule has been notified by Ministry of Personnel, Public Grievances and Pensions, which come under the Prime Minister himself, the ministry as such. So tenure has been reduced, and also government has been given the discretion to decide conditions of service. So there is no express provision made in the rules for this, means government has the power to decide conditions of service. Even the salary of the Chief Information Commissioner has been fixed at 2.5 lakh and for Information Commissioners at 2.25 lakh. So this has been announced. So you can see the rules actually also have been notified without any consultation. So, an RTI activist, Anjali Bhardwaj of Satark Nagrik Sangathan, says government had amended the RTI Act in July, even the president's assent came in August, but did not prescribe the rules. And now when the rules have been prescribed, the rules have been drafted and promulgated in a completely surreptitious manner, in a flagrant violation of procedures which have been laid down under pre-legislative consultation policy of 2014. So, this policy says that all draft rules should be placed in public domain for comments and suggestions from people, and then it should be notified. But the draft was not available in public domain, no consultations were held with members of the public, and the rules have been notified. And the rules actually give the power to the government to relax the provisions also. So this is a serious concern. Government has the potential to invoke these powers to determine even different tenures for different information commissioners at the time of appointment. So if any information commissioner is not functioning as per the requirement of the government, he can just be dismissed, his term can be ended and he's gone. So there's no independence for the RTI, for the information commissioners. The Central Information Commission as well as State Information Commissions function under it. So this is regarding the act as such, to how the act was amended. Now the rules have been notified under the amended act. So originally RTI Act had Central Information Commission for having a term of 5 years, Information Commissioners under him having a term of 5 years as well, and the body, Central Information Commission, having the status of same as Central Chief Election Commission, the Central Election Commission as such. So the government argued, the present government argued, that what is the need for CIC to have the status of Election Commission? That was the independence which it was assured, but that has been completely snatched away from it by this amendment. So here you can see Central Information Commission will now hold office as prescribed by the center, whatever the center says. No fixed tenure. Fixed tenure is the first condition for independence. If you are not assured of a fixed tenure, you can be removed at any point at the will of and whim and fancy of the government, then you will never question the government. Then your second point is information commissioners will also hold office, not just Central Information Commission, but even Chief Information Commissioner, but also information commissioners, they will hold office as prescribed by the center, and pays, perks, other conditions, services of condition also will be prescribed by the center. Everything will be prescribed by the center, nothing fixed. No status as such as the election commission. But it was passed. The government got this bill passed. So the term has changed, salary has changed. So this is the thing. And also here is a point that at the time of appointment, Chief Information Commissioner and information commissioners receive pensions or any other retirement. If they are receiving pension or other retirement benefits for previous government service, their salaries will be deducted by that amount equal to that pension. But now that will not happen. Those provisions have been removed. Because they are retired officers or something, so they already received pensions. So the salary given here has those deductions. But government says now there will be no deductions. They will get that salary also, and whatever pension they are getting, that also they will get. So you get the money, but you don't get the independence, you don't get the status. You don't question. Take the money. That's what the government is doing. Then next is reply to plea for entry of women into mosques, Supreme Court. So this is a petition filed in the Supreme Court by a couple. This is a Muslim couple from Pune, and they say that Muslim women should be allowed to enter mosques and worship there without gender discrimination. So the Supreme Court has asked the government to respond to this petition in 1 week. Also, others have been made party to this petition, like the court has directed All India Muslim Personal Law Board, Central Waqf Board as such also, and National Commission for Women is also a respondent here. So it was, this petition came in April 2019. And the court said that it is compelled to hear this petition because of the verdict in Sabrimala temple case too. So in this case, ban on women of a certain age group on the entry on temple had been removed as such because it was unconstitutional and discriminatory. So similar demand is being made by Muslim women now, that Muslim women should also not be barred. The petitioners also say that there is no such gender discrimination to offer worship in Mecca, in the mosques in the holy city. So why here in India such discrimination is there and women cannot enter mosques? It is said at present women are allowed to offer prayers in mosques under Jamaat-e-Islami and Mujahid denominations, and they are barred from entering into mosques by the predominant Sunni faction. So the couple argued that such a bar is violative of Article 44 of the Constitution, which encourages the state to secure a uniform civil code for all citizens by eliminating discrepancies between various personal laws currently in place. Then next is CSIR offers free mapping of Indian genomes. So this is regarding IndiGen initiative. So this is a program managed by CSIR bodies, that is CIR, Institute of Genomics and Integrative Biology, and CSIR, Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology. CSIR is Council for Scientific and Industrial Research. So anyone looking for free mapping of the entire genome can sign up for this initiative. So under this initiative, the individual will get a card and access to an app which will allow them and the doctor to access clinically actionable information on their genomes. So this is actually a project of CSIR, a 6-month project in which 1,000 Indians have had their genomes scanned in detail. So these Indians have been chosen from across the country to represent the width of genetic variability too. And the aim of this exercise is twofold. First is to test if it's possible to rapidly and reliably scan several genomes and advise people on health risks that are manifest in their genes, and also to understand the variation and frequency of certain genes that are known to be linked to diseases. So individually also it will help, and also the genes which are present in Indian genomes of Indians, what is their variation, what is their frequency, and these are specific genes linked to diseases, understanding them in the population of India. So that is those are the twofold objectives of this initiative. So, and everyone signing up, it is also clarified, will not be guaranteed a scan because there's already a backlog of at least 400 individuals presently. This is what the CSIR scientists say. But then they can, for a fee, get it done in some time. So, pathological laboratories, the way they do scans, similarly, companies can do such genome sequencing also for a price. So, here you have the genome mapping project detailed out. So, there's a need to develop therapies for various diseases. So, genome mapping will help in that. You know, predictive diagnosis and precision medicine can be provided. So, Indians whose genomic data will be catalogued in the first phase. It's a project under Department of Biotechnology, which CSIR is implementing. And this is explaining what actually genome sequencing means. So, to understand genome sequencing, you should also understand what is the genome, what is a gene. Starting from, actually, you should understand what is a cell. So, entire body is made up of cells. A number of cells together make up tissue. Number of tissues together make up an organ. Like liver is an organ, heart is an organ. So, an organ is made up of a number of tissues. And tissues are made up of cells. So, that's the idea. So, single cell. A child is born from a single cell. So, that cell multiplies and, you know, the child grows for 9 months as such in the womb too. So one single cell, actually every cell has a nucleus, and in the nucleus you have chromosomes. Humans, different species have different number of chromosomes. Humans have 23 pairs of chromosomes. So here you can see these are the chromosomes. So this chromosome, it looks like this. If you pick up one chromosome and one strand as such, so this is the chromosome. So it's bound like a ribbon bound. So this, when you unwind it, this is how it looks. This winding wire is actually the DNA. So that is, and these are the, you know, a section of the DNA is a gene. So gene has specific information, information about protein synthesis. So that is called a gene. So this ribbon, you can think of it like something like the old times cassettes, you know, CD cassettes. So that you had that CD tape ribbon. You know, so the magnetic tape, so that had to be wound. So on that tape there are songs. Say on side A, side B of a cassette you have five songs each. So looking at this tape, if you move the tape, you will not come to know where a song starts and where a song ends, but you know when you hear it that this is the point where the song ends, where this is the point where the song begins. So information is on it, embedded in it, but you can't see it. So that's how DNA is also. So DNA has information on it. So one section or one part of the DNA which has that specific information is called a gene. So there are number of genes on the DNA. So from where the gene starts and ends, you can know only if you know the information which it carries. So this is the entire, you can see detailed photo being given to. So this is the cell. In cell, this is the nucleus and this is a chromosome. Each part of it is called chromatid. The end is called telomere. These are PQ arms. The center point is called centromere. And it is wound. The way we saw it over here, it's wound. The DNA is what winds it. So when you untangle this, you can see, open it, it's this double helical structure. This DNA is also wound on these histones and nucleosomes. So this is the DNA, what we are interested in. Double helical ring. And this DNA, you can see, it is like a ladder. So these are called nucleotide pairs. And there are two pairs which join together in the center, so base pairs, base pairs which join. And there can be four types of these nucleotides that are A, G, C and T in DNA. Adenine, guanine, thymine and cytosine. So that is also there in A and T pair and C and G pair with each other. So that is what is a genome, DNA, a gene. And genome is the entire genetic sequence. So what is gene mapping and gene sequencing is also detailed out. Gene mapping is charting the positions of the genes on the DNA molecule. So what is the genes, where are the genes on a DNA molecule? If you know it, that means you have created a map of the genes. So this is there, and then you can see what is, so it is less detailed. Gene mapping and gene sequencing, basically gene mapping is identifying the location, charting the positions of the genes on the DNA molecule or chromosome, and the distance in linkage units, where in which between which genes is a particular gene located. So you just create a map of the genes. So it identifies the landmarks of the genome. Major landmarks are identified the way we have important landmarks in a map. So that is gene mapping. So it is less detailed, it's cheap, less time consuming. While gene sequencing, if you say, then it is completely detailed. So it's the entire sequence of nucleotides in a segment of DNA detailed out. So it gives out the full sequence, outcome is fully detailed, it's expensive and time consuming. So that's the difference between gene mapping and gene sequencing. So what we are talking over here above, coming back to that, is regarding gene sequencing, genome sequencing. So now you'll understand this better. Genome sequencing is a technique that allows researchers to read the genetic information found in the DNA of anything. DNA is present in everything, bacteria, plant, animals, virus, except viruses, all living organisms have DNA. Viruses may have RNA, not DNA. So that is there. So there are some viruses who have only RNA. Otherwise, every living organism has DNA. So sequencing means determining the order of base. So we saw this entire DNA and these nucleotide base pairs. So identifying the sequence of these base pairs, like A, G, T, C. What is the sequence? So this A, G, C, T are the bases, nucleotide bases. So they are adenine, guanine, cytosine and thymine. So sequencing, ordering these base pairs is what genome sequencing is all about for the entire DNA. So it's a huge time consuming task. Then next is, so this has been done for Indians presently. So human genome project has already been put prepared. So human genome has been prepared, which it was a huge grant project with US spearheading it. But now we are having India specific information also taken in through this experiment, through this initiative, IndiGen initiative. Then next is US seeks roadmap to restore normalcy in Kashmir. So, USA has sought a roadmap from India to political and economic normalcy in Kashmir, and it has also called for immediate release of all political detainees. So, actually, we have seen the US Congress questioning the US administrators on the situation in India in Jammu and Kashmir, and now the administrators say that we have already initiated talks, and now again, it is acting Assistant Secretary of State, that is U.S. Secretary of State for South and Central Asia, Alice Jewells. She said that we continue to press for the release of detainees and for full restoration of everyday services, and also a roadmap for restoration of political and economic normalcy in Jammu and Kashmir by the central government. So it is said most of the top level and second rung separatists of Jammu and Kashmir have been taken into preventive detention, and also mainstream leaders including former Chief Minister Omar Abdullah and Mehbooba Mufti have been either detained or placed under house arrest. So this is there, plus also normal life has been impacted. Daily life of nearly 8 million residents has been severely impacted since Jammu and Kashmir special status has been revoked. So the body also says, she says, Alice G. Wells says that we have seen progress because 4 million postpaid mobile phone users have had services restored, but SMS and internet is still restricted, and journalists also face challenges in access while reporting due to the security restrictions. Also, at the same time, it has called for Pakistan Prime Minister also. She said that we welcome Pakistan Prime Minister Imran Khan's unambiguous statement in September 2019 at UN that anyone who crosses from Pakistan to carry out violence in Kashmir are enemies of both Pakistan and Kashmiri people. And US calls for constructive dialogue between India and Pakistan on the issue. Is there, and it says Pakistan should take sustained and irreversible steps against militants and terrorists in its territory. Then next is 24 elected unopposed in BDC polls in Kashmir. So this is regarding block level elections in Jammu and Kashmir. So Jammu and Kashmir panchayat elections were held in 2018. So you should know about that, and after that block level elections were to be held, but since Lok Sabha elections were scheduled, these elections were delayed. So panchayat elections in 2018 saw a total of 27,281 panches and sarpanches elected. Still, there are 12,776 vacant sarpanch and panch seats in Jammu and Kashmir. Right? And now from above the panchayat, you should know local self-government structure. There are panchayats, then you have blocks, and then you have the district. So the block level elections are held, and block level elections are indirect elections. So you should understand that these are indirect elections in the sense that panches will vote, panchayat, panch and sarpanch would vote for the members at the block level. So there were 310 blocks in Jammu and Kashmir where elections were held now in this month, October 2019, and out of these 310 blocks, 13 candidates who won are women. remaining are men. And out of these 310 blocks, you can see the headline which is there, 24 chairpersons were elected without contest. So in each block elections were held, so 24 chairpersons were elected without contest in 133 blocks in Kashmir Valley. So this is in Kashmir Valley where unelected elections without contest means there is no other candidate, only one candidate and he won. So 24 such uncontested elections took place. So this is not where common people vote, you should understand. These are indirect elections, means these panchayat members who have been elected by the people, they are voting for block level chairpersons. So that is what has happened. So in these 24 elected unopposed, 10 are from BJP and 14 are independent. So of course, if they are independent in the sense that if, because all other political parties we are seeing in Jammu and Kashmir, leaders are behind bars, they are not participating in the elections. Congress and the two political parties, their leaders are behind bars. We saw just now too, Mehbooba Mufti, Umar Abdullah, they are behind bars. So they have refused to participate in the elections. They have boycotted these elections. Because political party says with our leaders behind bars, we cannot participate in these elections. So it's Congress, National Conference, PDP, they have not taken part in the polls. Then this is the first election which has been held in Jammu and Kashmir after revocation of its special status in August. So, means elected unopposed means BJP has taken part in the elections, except BJP, other parties have boycotted. So, means BJP could have had its member at least there contesting. So, these would not have been uncontested posts, but we see independents it's true. So, rather than saying that all 24 chairpersons elected were from BJP, they said 10 were from BJP and 14 are independents, where BJP did not have its candidate stand. That is there. So, independents also, we know independents at any point of time join any political party, they become member of that party. So most cadres, you can see most cadres of the political parties except BJP are in detention. So cadres are in detention, only BJP members are there who can contest and win elections, and still they did not contest and allowed independents to be elected unopposed. That's understood. They are independents for the name's sake. So this is there. Also, Prime Minister Narendra Modi tweeted on this. The tweet said that I'm delighted to share that Block Development Council polls were held in Jammu and Kashmir, and these elections, it is said, they have been held for the first time since 1947. And the historic turnout, it is said, is of 98%, but these are not common people coming out and voting. Only the panchayat panches and sarpanches voted. So of course, they would have been given security and made to come for the voting. It's not the common people vote. So of course, turnout, everybody came and voted. And also it is said that my Prime Minister's tweet says that this shows people's unwavering faith in democracy and importance that they have got to grassroots level governance. But this is not true. It's not people who came and voted. It was indirect elections. It's very important, the message which has been given. And of course, it is said it was conducted in very peaceful manner. There was no violence. Direct elections are ones where people come out and vote. Common people come out and vote. But you know the condition in Jammu and Kashmir, and these were not common people, they were elected members, panches and sarpanches who voted. So this is there. This is regarding panchayat level elections which were held in Jammu and Kashmir in as such. Then next is, Brazil intends to allow Indians without visas. So now Brazil is working to implement a policy to facilitate faster entry for Indian travelers into the country. Means it will allow Indians to, and also it is considering the same thing for Chinese travelers too, to visit Brazil without a visa. So they will not need a visa. Already such a policy is there for citizens of US, Canada, Japan and Australia. And Brazil is considering extending this to India and China too. Also BRICS summit is to be held in Brazil, you know, soon. So this is going to boost intra-BRICS ties as such. So Brazil says we want to boost people-to-people contact between the two countries and increase foreign investment in Brazil. So for Indian tourists as well as business persons, visa-free travel would be possible. Then next is, criminal investigation opened into Mueller's Russia inquiry. So it is said for the last 2 years now, US President Donald Trump has repeatedly attacked the Russian investigation which is going on, Russia investigation. So he calls it hoax and illegal. And Special Counsel Robert Mueller actually gave his report on this investigation, in which he did not give a clear clean sheet to Donald Trump, but he said there's not sufficient evidence and the inquiry was closed. But now Mr. Trump has his own Justice Department open a criminal investigation into how it all began, how this investigation began. So it was an administrative review which was being overseen by Attorney General, which has now been converted into a criminal inquiry. That how did it all start? Why this Russia investigation was going on against US President Donald Trump? That 2016 presidential elections are being questioned. So John Durham has been appointed as a prosecutor, and he has the power to subpoena for witness testimony, documents, and also impanel a grand jury and file criminal charges. So it is criticized that Mr. Trump is using the Justice Department to go after his perceived enemies. Also, the FBI director James Comey, who under whose watch agents opened the Russia inquiry, had been fired by President Donald Trump. So this is an unusual situation because Justice Department is conducting criminal investigation against itself, so, looking into itself. So this is what's happening in US. Next is US to deploy mechanized forces in Syria. So we had seen US President Donald Trump suddenly announce that he's going to remove troops from Syria. And after the US troops left Syria, the Turkey invaded Syria, northeastern region of Syria, and the Kurdish forces here, who had supported President Donald Trump in Syria in its fight against Islamic State, were left without any support. And Turkish invasion resulted in these Kurds now taking support from the Syrian government. They were the opposition forces of Syria actually, but they had to go to the Syrian government under Bashar al-Assad, the Syrian government which is supported by Russia. So they had negotiation talks with Russia and took its support, and now Russia and Turkey met in Moscow. The Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan, he met the Russian President Vladimir Putin in Moscow, and there they had this deal in Sochi as such, too, that they would be ending the fight which is going on, the Turkish invasion in northeastern Syria against Kurds. It will give 5 days ceasefire as such, in which Kurds would be allowed to leave the territory, and then joint patrol would be undertaken in this region by Turkey and Russia. So this is what the USA left a vacuum in Syria, and this has been filled up by Russia. And now US President Donald Trump, again US administration, has changed its stance and says that it will strengthen its military presence in Syria with mechanized forces. To earlier President Donald Trump's, his line was that we have to opt out of these costly wars which are going on in countries. So he opted out, but without thinking of the consequences, it seems, because now it is said that we strengthen our military presence in Syria, but it says with mechanized forces, in the sense troops will not be stationed there to such an extent, but mechanized forces, that is tanks and other military assets, will be here. So they say this will be done to prevent Islamic State fighters seizing oil fields and revenue in Syria. So this is what US Defense Secretary announced. So this is latest twist in President Donald Trump's confusing policy on Syria. Because on this decision to pull out from Syria, even the US Parliament, that is the Congress, gave a backlash to President Trump. Even in the key Republicans of his own political party, they also were shocked and criticized the move. So this is there. You can see vacuum left by Mr. Trump's partial withdrawal had created an opening that Russia exploited by moving its forces in the area. And you can see Ankara and Moscow, which halted, had an accord. That is Turkey and Russia, which halted Turkey's military incursion into northeast Syria. Then next is credit flow growth gets festive boost. So after lackluster growth in credit as such for the last several months because of slowing economy, now in the festive season during Diwali, we are seeing that banks are extending loans worth over 1 lakh crore. So this is the extension of loans being done in the last 3 fortnights ending 25th October 2019. So, Finance Ministry had actually asked public sector banks to organize Shamiana meetings in several districts in the month of October to extend loans to non-banking finance companies and retail borrowers like home buyers, farmers, etc. So, through NBFCs, banks reach last mile customers also, and they have extended these loans. So, credit growth has been given a boost this festive season in the month of October. So, this is the rising credit offtake being shown. Then next is last news. In a flip-flop, Orisha government retracts advisory on deposits. So Orisha state government actually had given an advisory to its various departments cautioning them about depositing funds in banks. So this is what the Orisha state government said, that health of banks, and looking at the media reports, is a concern. And also deposits, if you put a deposit in a bank, the latest cases of PMC Bank, Punjab and Maharashtra Bank, if deposits are there and something happens, amount which would be returned to the depositors is only up to 1 lakh rupees. So deposits are insured up to only rupees 1 lakh. So this is what the Orisha state government told its departments. So state government said, looking at the health of banks from my media reports and only deposits up to 1 lakh are insured, government departments, PSUs or agencies have to care very carefully, have to be very careful while keeping deposits in any banks. And proper inquiry about the financial health of the concerned bank has to be done for making any deposit as such. And it said that this will be the personal responsibility of the concerned authority. So if government money is, government fund is being put in banks, then it should be the personal responsibility of the concerned authority. They should be very cautious of in which bank they are putting the money. So this was the advisory which Orisha government gave, and this resulted in sharp rebuke from the RBI. So Orisha government has now retracted this advisory to its departments. So RBI, in a strongly worded letter, advised Orisha state government against giving such directions. So advisory has now had not gone down well with the RBI, which has given assurance about the safety of the Indian banking system. But then what has happened with PMC Bank does not assure people. So RBI said that such advisories coming from public authority may create unnecessary misgivings among public and may have unintended consequences for the financial system stability, which is true. So state government has clarified now that it does not have any view on the health of any particular bank, but it said that advisory was only meant to avoid opening of new accounts and shifting of government funds meant for welfare and development activities of government without any reason from one bank to another. So you should be cautious in that, is what it meant. But Punjab and Maharashtra Bank's case is one which creates such conditions where you doubt what happens to security or what is the security of a deposit which you have in any bank. Punjab and Maharashtra Cooperative Bank has now been barred from carrying out business transactions for 6 months. Depositors can withdraw only up to 1000 rupees is what RBI said originally. Then it was extended 10,000 rupees, but that is it. It is said that Punjab and Maharashtra Bank has 11,000 crore of public deposits, which they are not going to get back. Each one will get only 1,000 rupees back. So this bank was started off in 1984 in a small room in Bombay, and it became one of the top 10 cooperative lenders in the country, and it has 137 branches in 6 states as of March 2019. A total deposit of 11,000 crores, as we saw, and advances, loans which it has given is of around 8,383 crores. So it started in September 19 when PMC Bank MD, Managing Director, confessed of fraud in a meeting with RBI. So MD documents details in a letter to the central bank regarding this, and RBI appoints administrator and suspends the board. And RBI allows, and on September 24, the next day, RBI allowed PMC Bank customers to withdraw only up to 1,000 rupees per account. And then next day, limit was raised to 10,000 rupees per account. But then, of course, this puts people in jeopardy. People have been affected. There have been many suicide cases also with respect to PMC Bank case. So, that's the case. And then 10,000 has been increased to 25,000 per account. But that is it. You can't take out. Because even if you have 20 lakh rupees in your account, you can have maximum 25,000 limit. That is it. So this is how banks keep your deposits safe. So both government banks and private banks have to follow the norms of RBI. Commercial banks are required to keep 22.75% of depositors' money as various assets and reserves as such. And banks have to maintain at least 9% of the money lent as capital all the time. This much money has to be kept as capital. And when a bank is in a stress, RBI puts it under prompt corrective action to help it recover. And if situation does not improve, RBI also suggests mergers with strong banks. And as a last resort, you can know that deposit insurance is of 1 lakh rupees only. So that is the safety cover. So this is the insurance in deposits. So Indian deposits compensation has last been fixed over 25 years ago and it has remained 1 lakh rupees. So in the last 25 years, the money value has changed to such an extent, but then this has not changed. Inflation has increased, but the compensation among the deposit which is insured still remains 1 lakh rupees. And if you look at the ratio to percentage of deposits in banks of people which is of less than 1 lakh rupees is only 7.8%. 20.4% deposits are over 15 lakh rupees. So that is it. These are the news items. Thank you. And wishing everyone a very happy Diwali too. Thank you.